a tough day at work today. Steve and Kirk think I suck. Throw back a few wobbly pops, feeling down on my luck. And the interns ruin every show. But it's still where we wanna go. It's Mike and the Minifans. 'Cause nobody had any better plans. You wanna be with DC and R. A. Minifan. The host can't see it's Mike and the Minifans.
Wow, wow. Hey, how are you? Welcome to Mike and the Minifans, the longest hour in recorded broadcast history. What a week. The week we had the first two rounds of the Fawn Squad Invitational. We had the big dog Ponzi scheme revealed on the show. We had the oldest looking 38-year-old in recorded broadcast history, probably in the history of the world. Kamala, everything about a week, but I'm joined by a great panel. We're joined by Tim Ridgels. How are you, Tim?
Good, BA. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. Actually, Freddie Lynn said BA's haircut looks great, so
fire.
Had to throw that in. Looks fire. Sorry. We're joined by Michael Montante.
Hey, how are you?
Hey, how good, are you? And Pizza Joe, I'd see your curtains are still fucked up, man.
Like, they'll always be. I think even if I got new curtains when I'm on the show, I'd have to get the old ones back on just to make sure they look fucked up.
Those look like domestic violence curtains.
It'd be between me and my roommate. You know, we get drunk, we might wrestle.
Hey, who's to say?
They look like they look like CSI Miami. You know, like that's where the blood splatter is or something. Don't put a UV or like a, what's those called, UV light on those curtains.
In hotel rooms.
Exactly.
What was the show back on MTV where they had the fucking UV light?
Oh yeah, fuck, what was that show where they would like do a room makeover or something?
Yeah, it was really embarrassing. Carry on.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
I apologize. Busy week. We got a lot to get to.
Busy week. Very busy week. I have three full pages of notes. I think I want to.
Room Raiders.
No, they go to like college age kids' houses and like put them on like glass, like fucking, hey, check out this dude's fucking
room Raiders. Yeah. Holy fuck, Room Raiders.
That's awesome. But,
Room Raiders saw Willie G's room. Holy fuck. That would be fucking crazy, you know? But crazy week, like it kind of started. We'll get into the Daver and the Minifan kind of stuff in a sec, but I wanted to start with Coleman, like total simp of Kelly Keeks. You know, Kelly Keeks gets faked out by the Juke Em Coleman account, Juke Me Coleman, and then Kelly Coleman's like is simping for her. Then on the show, he's like, no, I wasn't simping, like a classic thing. He says it's in the Tickler file, but like Coleman is like, I think he's like in the closet now about being a simp. He's like in the closet about being a simp towards these ladies. Like he loves because they got high or whatever it was. But what did you think about this? And it kind of led to like a old tweet off between Justin and Coleman. But what did you think about this? And Pizza Joe, what did you think?
Well, it's pretty fucking gay. I mean, right off the bat. To be kind of like simping. I liked when they played that clip of like what the day he was like, this is the greatest podcast ever. They're talking about what they call a vagina. Like I'm 28. I'm not that far from 23, 22. Was definitely not listening to any podcasts like that. And I thought Kirk could even went even harder on Coleman about that because
100%.
Yeah. I mean, I'm glad that what I was happy about was Coleman finally got a taste of what Kirk can do to you because he had Gus for so long. And then for Kirk to just kind of hammer him down, that was good. And I'll say Coleman took it off the chin pretty well because I bet he does like to take it off the chin a little bit. So,
Montante, what do you got?
So obviously, actually, the one thing that I agree with Coleman on is 2 years when you're 21 and in college and you're 23 in the real world, that's like 6 years elsewhere. That you do change a lot in those years, but I think he wasn't being genuine when he was saying it's my favorite pod. If you look at him, he has some embarrassing tweets at Barstool. He was just trying to get hired there any which way he could. I think it was a strategic thing to look at a podcast during that time, you know, kind of the height of not maybe the Me Too movement, but It was, you know, a big feminism movement at Barstool, and he was just trying to take his way in. You know, what would be easier getting high to Barstool? Tweeting at Part of My Take or going at the Because We Got High, you know, people to get in as a producer?
I agree.
I think it was strategic. That was never his favorite podcast. Never. That was all done intentionally. I don't get why he didn't say as much.
But I don't remember. Like when you say, why'd you tweet it? Don't say because, I forgot.
Because the reason might be I was just trying to get in the Barstool any way I could. And then when you say that, Kirk then looks at you and goes, okay, is that what you're doing here?
Well, yeah.
Who amongst us, if like, you don't go back through.
Go ahead, Tim.
Your Twitter history. So from late, 2015 all the way through 2016, I simped for Donald Trump. I simped for the Island Boys. I
simped for something wrong with that.
Billy Mitchell. I simped for fucking everyone. Like it's what you do on Twitter. So like you have.
I'll say this: if you look up Facebook on this day, even the biggest liberals were dropping the F slur just on Facebook. You know, so but it is crazy because it kind of
started. She's broken up with. What's his name?
No.
She was dating the dude that does the where you eat all the nasty shit sitting around the bar. The skinny dude, the runner.
Vibs.
Was she broken up with Vibs? They dated for quite a while.
I'm a Barstool guy. I did not. I feel like Kelly Keeks is like 5'11".
Were they broken up when like he was sending all these like
Kelly Keeks is kind of like the village bicycle at Barstool. Everyone gets around.
The only thing I don't like about Kelly Keeks saying, is people are saying bug eyes, dude. She's like all the time just bugged out.
Oh, I like your eyes. I'm a Keeks guy.
What about the voice?
I kind of like
the voice. Her voice is actually worse than her appearance.
Okay.
She looks like that thing in Nightmare Before Christmas. It's fantastic. Like it's got a.
I did not know the Vibs thing. That's pretty surprising to me.
Yeah.
I thought that was
I missed that one.
I don't know. Whatever.
But he said that because then it started this whole like old tweets exposed, and I think we have this dynamic in the producer booth. We have Coleman. He's the closet liberal. He's definitely a lib. You know, and then we have Justin Trudell, which I'm starting to call him Len Callahan because he is a very right wing. He's a right winger. So now in the producer booth, you have a big Republican and a closet liberal. Like I thought it would be funny if they start their topics for the show. Like Justin is just bringing up total right wing things, and then Coleman is doing. Like woke PC shit. So I don't know, but it was the old tweet off. Kirk was right. It was like it was kind of cringe on Twitter. Like after a couple of days, it's like okay, we get it. You know.
Oh, it was. Yeah. When they actually brought it to the show account, like that was like all right, good lord, that's too much. The thing that I thought was the most indicting thing I think on Coleman, you know, simping for. That terrible feminism weed podcast is one thing. Tweeting at Bailey Carlin 200-300-400-500-600 times, that's actually inexcusable. I don't know what was Bailey's role? Because like I said, you could go back to him just trying to get in there. Was he hiring people?
I think he was like one of the higher ups in the production side of it.
I think he was social. No, he was a social guy.
So if you're, you know, tweeting at him nonstop and doing videos about how you need to get the parcel by any means necessary, would that be like adding to my theory of just trying to get there? Because no one's a Bailey Carlin fan, right?
I 100% agree with you that he was tweeting at Kelly Keeks and anyone at Barstool to get a job. I think you're 100% right on that. But I don't really – I think where he is now, that's like – it's higher up than just being a producer in New York. Like being the producer of the Kirk Minahan show alone has more value to it than being just a random producer in New York who goes around and follows fucking Caroline. She does her stupid fucking videos, or when Clemmer does the history of New York City. Yeah. Like but I think the head producer of the Kirk Minahan show has more value at Barstool than that.
But that was never on his radar 2-3 years ago.
No,
2 years ago. Not. You know, he was just old. That was when the only office was New York. It was big. Money was flying. Everyone was getting contracts. Fucking, they're hiring a kid from the San Francisco Giants game because he's funny looking, has red hair. Like, anyone was getting hired at that point, so he was just looking for in, I think.
And look, he was the first one out, too. Like the layoffs, boom, you're there, you're out. Like, just like that, so.
Yeah, Coleman's they're seeing a good week. I have noticed there hasn't been any YouTube shorts in 7 days, so I don't know why the that kind of stuff isn't still consistent, but the Twitter's been good.
He's the best to ever do the drops.
Yeah, the drops are amazing. Like the mutt, the hit the car on mutt was what all time drop.
He's weaponized. He's weaponized it. It hit the car. Like he's weaponized it. It's beautiful.
His drop game is stellar. He has a stellar. I think it's better than because mutt said it on the show where it was like. He always implements new ones. Like he's always evolving the drops. So
and he has good anticipation. He'll play a drop so quick that he has an idea where the conversation is going to go before it goes there. And he's quick on the button. So he's good.
Steven Caligridis said Coleman the drop lord. Interesting. The
drop. Fine,
lord. Yeah. I think he's got to go back and look at and listen to the Jerry drops too. I think those have a history of the show.
But it is kind of like I guess you can mix in one or two.
It's a different, it's a different era. Jerry doesn't get brought up anymore.
I guess
it's not like it was 2 years ago.
There's nothing like Nazi stuff. One, those are just good drops.
Nazi stuff, yeah, that's a good one. But it's over.
But so this Coleman tweeting at Kelly Keegs turns into KFC is exposed as he knows nothing. Like he's never in tune to what's going on. He talks about on the Barstool Live. Coleman was going after Kelly Keegs and got exposed. Like the guy doesn't know anything off the top. He is completely unprepared. He's terrible. Like I've been saying this for weeks and weeks. I actually think he is the top hater of KMS in the New York office. But then he goes on the Unnamed podcast, and I thought it was a great success, the Unnamed podcast, but the Unnamed show, and he takes no responsibility for what happens
that
in
was
New York.
That was remarkable. A minute later, he's like listening to their quick, it wasn't even like a quick, like long diatribe of why he was wrong. They mentioned 2 points. And he's like, all right, yeah, you're right on that. What a weird instinct though. He'd be like, oh, 0% for me.
No, he takes no accountability, no ownership. What
he's not a leader. Like that to me, like, right, when there was a three of them, when it was Dan, Dave, and Kevin, right? It was Dan and Dave, and then Kevin was just kind of the filler. Where I don't think he's a leader. He's a good supporting cast, like great supporting role guy. He does his KFC radio on his own island, but he's not going to lead an office. It's just not his thing.
Yeah.
And he's not a leader.
I don't know.
Tim, go ahead.
Like, I feel like this is a lot of like post Kirk coming to Barstool sentiment. Like KFC versus Dave, like every day on Barstool Radio was basically outside of like, pardon my take, the best content they had. They would fucking go hard. And that's the only reason it existed and the reason it existed for the time period it did. And it was fantastic. So like, I feel like Kevin finally got paid, finally got like acknowledged, which like, I think that's been a thing with him. But like seeing KFC on like Survivor and shit was cool. It was like good to see him back because he fucking blows now. He just blows. But like there was a time where he was basically right there with everyone and he was great at what he
but
did.
Even,
and people
but even
just on, shit on him now. But like,
but even whatever. On Surviving Barstool, he was so delusional where he's like, I'm gonna say this amazing speech and
that
get
was
the
tough. That was like, real tough.
Okay. Touche on that. That was
he's a delusional horrible. Guy. And KFC's lazy. Like he got paid, whatever. He's lazy. He's lazy. I'll say this.
So he's Albert Hainsworth of Barstool. Is that what you're saying?
But
same work ethic.
KFC what? Was.
How can you say that? He's been there so long.
I would say he's lazy.
A lot of people have been there for a while. Doesn't mean they still work.
Kirk tells KFC on the Unnamed show, okay, you have a delay, you got to leave. And he's like, can I say one more thing? And just repeats the same thing he's been saying for like 20 minutes. And then tries to plug his stupid fucking stupid idea of this content draft. And it was like, this is the worst idea ever.
You're on a show with like literally one of the biggest people on like social media, Dave Portnoy, why wouldn't you try to take 5 seconds and plug your shit? Like that's Dave would want him to do that.
Yeah, but he's been there for a decade. He just he shouldn't have to plug anything.
but he plugs his bullshit show. But all, he's not even part. He, like, as a leader of men, you lead by example. He should be in the content draft. He's not even a participant in it. So he's like, that's what I'm saying. KFC was exposed. KFC was exposed. But I thought the unnamed show was really good. I love that stuff. I know that.
Bring up was too about KFC. Whitney even asked him because he goes, "Well, I asked Tommy to do Barstool Radio. He said no." Well, it's like, all right. Well, what is Tommy doing day to day at Barstool where he can't do Barstool Radio?
No. By the way, if that is a brilliant move by Tommy. That's a because that worked out best for him. He probably saw the disaster that was gonna be. And he fucking sidestepped it. And he looks like a fucking genius.
Yeah, but that's when Kevin has to say, no, like, listen, like, you're fucking doing this. Because...
Well, he doesn't respect. Well, no. If Portnoy asked that, he does it.
Yeah,
he doesn't respect.
That's exactly. Dave pushed back and said, no, I'm still the boss of the goddamn New York office. Like, so if Dave was like, hey, Tommy, we need you to do this, I'm pretty sure you would have done it.
It
like,
doesn't get to that and point. Tommy, do you want to do this?
People are assigning this responsibility to KFC to like keep this office going, whatever. Dave Portnoy himself on Kirk's show, everyone saw it, basically was just like, no, I still run that motherfucker.
No,
like,
that's still my office. That's bullshit. That's him covering for KFC.
Yeah.
Oh, he wants to cover for Kevin. That just shows you never listen to Barstool Radio. Like, I'm pretty sure Dave would never want to cover
for Kevin. I feel like he is a bit softer 100%. On Kevin. I think he's a bit softer 100%. On Kevin now.
Really?
Yeah, because during the Barstool Radio thing, after Kevin leaves, and he's like, yeah, that was a terrible idea, the content draft and all this
softer
stuff.
On like, Kevin by being like, hey, no, I'm going to give Dan fucking $100 million to open a fucking...
But
allowing Penn to like do that, like, hey, I'm going to take basically all the talent and we're going to move it halfway across the country and build a fun
house. But KFC couldn't do that because he's not a natural born leader. He doesn't have what Dan has.
Well, another question answered on the show. There's a 10-year lease. They can't go anywhere.
Well, also, I would say KFC needs to look inward. He maybe should spend some time with Sneakers, our leader of men, or he should take a six to twelve hour six to 12-hour seminar on the Andy Mayo, Mayo management.
I don't think Mayo could save him. My last thing on this is if KFC had one third of the attitude and the work ethic that Dan had, they've been around there at the same time. They both have Tim's rolling his eyes. I'm not sure why. Maybe explain afterwards. But if he just did one third of what Dan did, you wouldn't have to have Portnoy coming in and saving his ass. It's like, oh, I'm still the head honcho of New York. KFC would be running it like he should be. He tried to run it. He just doesn't have it. He's not a leader. And so he respects him enough to come in there and bail him out.
He's not supposed to be a leader. Dave Portnoy himself said, no, I'm the leader there still.
Because he's covering for him.
So you're passing the ball. Why would he cover for a guy?
Because he's been there for long enough to where he respects him. He's not going to throw him under the bus. It's not a hard concept to understand.
Thrown him down under the bus for years.
Portnoy can't be the New York office guy if he's not there. This is
pre-Barstool Minahan revisionist history. Like, I don't.
I would have said the same thing a week ago.
It's
common sense if you follow Barstool.
You can't be in charge of an office.
It's common sense if you followed Barstool from the time Kirk started there till now. But if you did before, I think it would be a different
vibe.
There's nothing Dave and KFC ever left. Like they murdered each other. Like literally. That's why Dave was like, if we do this, we're not going to be friends anymore, because it ruined his relationship with KFC, because it was just horrendously personal and like hate filled at times. It was literally just them. So that's what his problem with Whitney and Kirk and them is. Like, if we do this, we're going to end up hating each other.
KFC doesn't have it in him anymore, though. He doesn't have that in him anymore.
I think
he doesn't need to have it in him anymore.
I think we could all agree, though. KFC is an uninformed, person in general.
He's
uninformed, and I feel like he's winging it or whatever. He's checked out.
He's intentionally distant.
He's checked out,
and he knows he has a place there. He doesn't have to do too much. If he's fully involved, still, he will get dragged into the mud with people like Kirk. So him staying a distance is best for his own brand and his opinion. And I don't blame him. He's not gonna get in trouble. He won't get fired for it, but he's just not gonna take that office to level that maybe you thought he would maybe 3 or 4 years ago. That's all. There were times 3 or 4 years ago where there was legitimate chatter in this area that he would make the move. Like, was he going to get poached from Barstool to go to the Fan and like take over for Francesa? I'm not even like kidding. Like that was a real thing like 3 to 4 years ago. And it's just is not a thing anymore. Now he's getting bailed out by Portnoy. But anyway,
my last thing about the unnamed show is, can they get a fucking name for it?
Because I like the name.
I don't, because Kirk did this already with the fucking golf gambling show where they didn't have a name for it. And then he does this show. There's no name. Like, the shtick's over. Fucking name the show. Just name it.
What's like Tim doing name over there? But yeah, I thought it was a great show. It was funny when they were all yelling like over each other. I had a PTSD from the producer search where I had all six of you guys on and you guys were all like yelling at each other. I was going to reach out to Kirk and be like, hey, if you need some help, like, or broadcasting, you know, via StreamYard, I could give you some tips, but because he gave me some tips.
Why Tim has a Christmas tree in the.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I keep it up. I like the light
all year.
I like it as a little nightlight.
There's so no way that's there in June.
Yeah, it is.
If he's got just it like now, it, it's gonna be on
it used to be behind my desk, and now I have it in.
There's a difference spot between February and June. It might come down, you know, somewhere in fucking May.
No,
if
no.
If you go past January with the Christmas tree, at that point, stay.
I like the light, right, man. It's nice. Like when you come down, like at night, like if the dogs are moving around or something, like I like the light. Like it's a nice light.
Wow, Jizz Wizard said Tim's a Biden supporter, so that's pretty
good. I might be riding with Joe for the next four. Like, dude, I want to see how deep this goes, man. Like, he is all fucked up right now.
Montante told me add this next. He said, "Can we talk about Tucker Carlson and Putin?" But I told him no. But we'll get into the next thing. So I just want to shout out the Fonz Golf tournament finale. I think will be live broadcasted on the network on Monday.
Shout out Bio. Did you guys cut them out? You guys cut them out. He didn't advance. Bio did bullshit. They robbed them.
Bio didn't make it through. So the finale will be Andrew Augustus, McFustaddy, Memes, and Nick from Ohio. So it'll be broadcast on Monday. I think me and Sneakers will be doing the color commentary. So it should be, if we can pull it off, it should be a fun thing. Because Kirk did say, he's like, the network has too many wrap-up shows now. And it is true. Like, not everyone could just do a wrap-up show. Like, there's like three or four. And this was what happened in the original network. So, but we'll get into the Minifan kind of drama of the week. And Davergate, you know, I was kind of called out about being like a middleman, like going after him privately, or privately being on his side, publicly trashing him. I did one tweet about when the Big Lard Barley loses.
10 out of 10. One of the best tweets I've seen in Twitter's history. Yeah.
Right. It was a great tweet. But I actually got sources told me that Daver actually, alongside his gambling addiction, he has a TGI Fridays addiction. He's reached
like, what is a TGI Fridays addiction?
He's actually reached out to people being like, there's half price mozzarella sticks tonight. Yeah. Can you just spell me $50? So, serious. I do. No, I don't.
That can't be fucking real. Dude.
It's not.
I'm just kidding.
I want it to be.
I want it to be so bad. Yeah, man.
How funny would it be if he was like, "I just need 50 for some mozzarella sticks."
Can I ask a question to Montante, these gentlemen? So okay, so I went hard, you know, for years, had, you know, a very very high credit limit with gambling. There was weeks, especially during the playoffs, where I'd have like a total of 20K in action and like hope to like bring in, you know, $2,000-$3,000.
Is that how you got the Shazat money?
No, but like that was just something that I used to do, but it's really, really like all consuming. And unless you're constantly like gathering data or synthesizing data, like literally 24 hours a day, you're just like garbage and you can't do it real. Like, I just want to ask them, like, what's your like units? Are you like $100 a game, $500 a game? Like
me?
Yeah, like how are you and David? Like, how do you guys roll? Like I because everyone talks about like you guys gamble, like you're big gamblers. And it's like I used to do like
No,
$1,000 on a hat.
Gambling pre-legalized gambling was different. When you had a limit, yeah, I put $20,000 on the Jets under 4.5 wins. I'm not doing that now because I don't have $20,000.
Did you really?
Yeah, I lost. Yeah. So I don't have that now. So literally, when I get
$20,000 on the Jets,
they won 5-11. It was like 8 years ago, 7 years ago. But now, when legalized gambling, I get paid. I pay my bills. I go to the bank. I take out a little allowance for the week, and I put $200 to $300 in my account. My unit is 50, and all it takes is a quick bad Saturday. You go 0-6 on a Saturday. Guess what? I still want to gamble. That's when I'll reach out to somebody, ask for $100, $200. I pay them back on time.
Okay.
What Daver was doing, I'm not sure. I knew this thing was bubbling for 3 weeks before it came out. I knew it was going to come to a head eventually.
But he's not doing hundreds of dollars a unit. He's just like bad streaks on stupid shit. Or like, what are we talking about? Wins.
So he's probably doing those crazy parlays at like tenfold of what he's actually.
He's probably doing like a bunch of parlays, and then he was Pizza Joe.
That is. Without knowing any inside knowledge, I'll be honest, if I do, because I know a lot, I would agree with that. That is an observation I made as well.
Like,
every gambler
shows their wins. Like, everyone wants to be like, yeah, I hit a $850 parlay that was four legs. Great, but what about the other 10 that you put $50 on that you lost? Like, that's
correct.
I'm a gambler. My unit's $100. Like, I know my limit. Offshore.
If
I lose a grand, that's it. I'm done, and I have to pay my bookie.
This is what happened. My tweet did express it. Daver was taking $60 from each of them, and then he was
No. Let's be accurate. The big dog parlay was $20 a person.
Okay, so he's taking $40. He was taking $40 from them, and he was putting them on 15 $2 parlays or whatever, and try and booking the bets, hoping they would lose. It is funny to think that I said this before. It's funny to think that like he was probably that's why I called it the big dog Ponzi scheme. Like he was trying to like go on this show that like 50 people watch and then like give out bad picks because he was trying to collect $40. It is funny to think about that, but I hope he is sensitive. Like I think he could come back from this. Like
it's funny. I called him earlier and he just texted me back. What's up? Like, what do you think? What's up, stupid? Like, what do you think I'm calling you about, bro? Like, what do you mean? What's
my up? Question was more like he's not going out and like betting $1,000 on a UFC.
No,
I don't know.
Like crazy shit. Like really thick, or like $1,000 on a tennis match. Well, it's like
that's the thing. If you're getting a low for $500, you're not betting $1,000.
I know David pretty well. I can't explain. I can't explain what he would be spending all his money on. That I can't explain.
Monster. He doesn't have kids, right? Like, I don't know. He doesn't have kids.
No.
He's not. Is he married? I'm not 100%
no.
sure.
No.
Like, this is the dude, part like, where. This is the part
money,
where.
Dude.
But this is the part where I like, this is where I start feeling bad because who knows how bad he was with money 10 years ago or something like that. Maybe he fucked up. Maybe like, so this is where it's like, oh, do we really want to speculate on how bad he is with money? Like that's where I kind of feel bad for the guy. If we stick to like this guy was, but again, why are you asking people for money?
That's the thing. Like,
I don't care about any of that. I just want to know the units. That's all I want to know. I just want to know where we're dealing with.
Cover your bets.
These units are like $5.
That's it. Like, for example, this week, right? My buddies are in Scottsdale at a bachelor party right now. I was invited.
Really?
You know what? Yeah.
I know somebody in Scottsdale right now, out of your area for a bachelor party. He's 34 years old.
It might be the same guy. It could be, potentially.
I'll DM you on the side.
Okay. But like, I said no because, A, like, I'm coaching hockey high school, so I can't. And, B, like, the funds right now, like, mortgage business is tight. Like, I don't have the extra.
Thanks, Joe.
Yeah. So.
Like, $500 for a bachelor party, like, you could spend that in, like, 2 hours. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I would spend $500 fast, you know? So, but any last thoughts on Daver, I guess, Tim, Montante?
I just want to know, like, how deep it was as far as that.
Yeah, goes. So without getting into too much detail, this thing bubbled up 3 weeks ago, and VD raised concerns to me. Even before he raised concerns to me, he was asking me generic questions without letting me know who it was. And I could tell something was up. And then he let me know. I was like, yeah, my guard's up with Daver. And I was like, oh, shit. Where Daver's mad at me is I jokingly told Meemaw, because that I thought Dave was buttering him up for a loan, because I know it happened like 3 or 4 years ago, and then it turns out he did. So I let
you murdered Dave left and right. Right.
No,
right.
No. This was inadvertent, because I know this would bubble to this.
I know it's well known, but like what? Like you're just murder.
No, I'm just giving a background story to what led up to
facts,
what happened.
Facts or facts speak the truth.
So I let VD know when all he was curious about this. Like, oh, you know, just he just reached out to Meemaw for a little loan. And that kind of bridged the gap for Meemaw and VD to share their war stories. And once that happened, but the one thing I will say is VD told Daver 5 to 6 times privately, come clean. It's not a big deal. It stays here. Don't worry about it. He either ignored it or just said, whatever. If you know VD, he's not just going to sit on that. VD's an online Looney Tune. So if he feels he's been wronged, he's going to come public with that.
When Daver called in and said, I'm not listening, I'm just calling.
Oh,
that was crazy. And then when he said the thing like, oh shit! Yeah, I did borrow $800.
Can I get? Can I get?
It is a bad look for the Portuguese.
I'll tell you why that happened.
That's basically like proceeding to the point like where it's like this person cannot like tell the truth and they automatically default to lying, which is like a sickness.
Well,
like,
he was actually so I'll shed a little light on that. The first time that when VD called in. He said something along the lines of, if there are any other Daver victims, joking, call in and share your story, right? So Meemaw, who's listening live, who's also lent him money, called Daver and goes, hey, you're not listening? No. Well, VD just called in, said some stuff. I'm going to call in right now and talk about the loan from 2 years ago. If you don't want me to call in, you call in yourself. So that's why if you listen back, Daver's second call, he doesn't say hello. He doesn't pussyfoot. He literally just goes, oh, yeah, I forgot. I gave Meemaw $1,500 as well. That's why. But when he's like, oh, no, I actually wasn't listening. And they're like, well, why would you call in? That's why. Meemaw literally called him directly. And that's why he reactionary called. So he wasn't lying there. He really wasn't listening.
He actually wasn't lying.
His hand was
someone forward. Someone did ask, is Daver in witness protection? And I think he is. And it's at he picked the spot that has 5 to 10. PGI Fridays in the radius. So, any final thoughts on Daver?
How long do you guys think he's out for?
I think like, forever, and I think he should have been in there on Wednesday. Because the truth of the matter is, he's not lying. He's paid everybody back. Take your lumps, joke about it, and go on.
Yeah, you gotta take your lumps, man.
Like, I don't think, but Daver's very sensitive. Like he's very, very sensitive. He was sensitive about me calling him a diva. Like it was all a joke. So he's a very sensitive guy.
When things are going well with KMS, Quantum Kirk, whatever, he'll go in. He'll retweet the show. You know, do X, Y, and Z. But things don't always go. Go in there, take your lumps. It's not the end of the world. You didn't kill anybody. You didn't do anything wrong. You paid everybody back. Go in there, take your lumps. It's not a big deal.
Go in there, say, I'm Daver Madoff. I had the big dog Ponzi scheme.
There's a dude that goes on consistently or like calls in and like does stuff consistently that ripped off his girlfriend to the tune of like $20,000.
Shout out Kyle.
And was just like, yes, I totally did all of that. But I can get you fucking Counting Crows tickets. Like, it's so weird. It's so weird that Daver's taking so much shit over this. Like, what I consider as a degenerate myself to be like a pretty minor infraction. It's hundreds, not thousands. Yeah. So, like, hundreds minor. You can fix, but like,
incredibly minor.
I mean, it says something shitty about you, but yada, 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 yada. That dude ripped off a chick he was like having sex with and like cohabitating with to the tune of like fucking 5 figures. And it's just
Kyle said he gets me tickets to the
Bruins. And
Kyle went on the show and then was like, yeah, I'm a piece of shit.
Yeah,
and then like called the girl. Daver was like, no, I don't want to go on the show. That's the difference. Yeah, take your lumps, it's over.
Correct.
But one's over hundreds of dollars and one's over like literally 5 figures. Like there's a massive difference there. And if it was gambling, but if it was gambling, it'd be a different thing too. Like you go 10 grand in the hole, like that's a rugged hole to get out of.
I did think it was crazy that Minifans reach out to Kirk for money too. Like that's kind of fucked up.
Yeah, that is. That's just taking.
And he says no every time.
Michael.
You're wasting
Michael
your time. Yeah, you're wasting your time. He's a selfish prick.
Are you going to close that sales deal, Montante?
We got a couple looming right now. We got a couple things.
A couple on the table.
Can we ask three questions and you don't just yes no questions? Like
sure,
and very ambiguous.
Sure.
Is it a Fortune 500 company?
No. Definitely not.
Does it start with S and end with A concrete?
No. We don't deal with liberal cocksuckers like Kirky. We keep that.
Anything to do with an
I don't have another question. Yeah,
let Joe crack one. But going to Dave or to another guy who's probably going to ask the Minifans for money is Mutt. Mutt is on an all-time low since the rundown. Like, he says he's DMing with Patrick Ford, like chatting. He also said he donates to like horse charities. Like, the guy doesn't have a job. He's donating to horse charities. And he's also going to be getting a loan, or he's getting a part-time job at Lowe's. Like,
Mutt, No, he's not. They came back the next day and refuted that.
Yeah.
But he's above that.
You failed the drug test. Can't operate a forklift. You're out.
I don't know. But Mutt,
training, fail.
I think Mutt's at an all-time low. Mutt might be going through something more than Dave.
You know what's annoying me about Mutt is I jokingly reached out to him because, you know, Steve from Gloucester, just so delusional and whatnot. And he said he wants Mutt, but Mutt won't get back to him. So I jokingly reach out to Mutt, and I'm like, hey, like, I'll send you a Calendly link. Let me know what works for you so you can get on
Stephen Bosco's podcast. Did you
say Calendly?
Yeah. Calendar to Calendly? Yeah,
no, there's an app called Calendly, and you click the link.
Actually,
and
I thought you were like, you know.
So I sent it to Mutt like twice. All you have to do is like jokingly respond. He just ignores it. Like, dude, it's obviously a joke. Like, have a little fun with it. Like, have an ounce of fun with it, Mutt. Like, obviously, I'm not being serious. I want you to go on fucking Stephen Gloucester's thing. He's in a weird spot where he's above the network and above the Minifans, but is at the same time not. It's a very weird balance he's trying to work with right now.
Disagree. Much
he, he's guy. Not above working, though. Fantastic. Like, you can't be a leader
Well, he is.
Like, and not work. Like, he said, like, his brother does really well for an alcohol distribution company. Go fucking work there. Like, get a goddamn job. It's been over a year. Like, there's no excuses anymore. Like, get a job. Like, you can't just...
I understand he has kids. How is he not bored out of his fucking mind?
That's the other thing, too.
Kirk doesn't have to do all these shows. Kirk's probably at home. He's probably like, all right, I did my four shows. I could do a fifth because I need to burn two or three hours tomorrow because I'm bored. You know? Go do something.
What about Mutt's wife being like, hey... Like, let's
Mutt's wife has to be like in the Chris Clemmer wife. Mutt's wife has to be in the Chris Clemmer wife coaching tree where
she can't be making like
she's an enabler.
It must be because like I at some point you just have to be like, you know what, the radio thing is over. It's probably not going to happen. Content, like, he's had a year to do content to make some like make his name known.
Is it crazy he doesn't have a podcast?
Yeah, like, he has done nothing to make himself worth value to a content company.
He's a lazy. Him and KFC should do a show called The Two Laziest People Ever, you know? Mutt and KFC. How much lazier?
I can't stand for the Mutt hate.
Defend Mutt for me, Tim.
It's hard to get made fun of.
Listen, okay. I think he's funny.
It's hard to get made fun of. It's hard to try to do something and get made fun of. It's hard to fucking keep, like, trying to do your thing, get made fun of, even though like it is good promotion, like, and there's a lot of people that understand that. It's just hard to get made fun of. Like, it sucks. Like, I don't know. Mutt's awesome.
John from Warren actually said Mutt is actively running from a job at this point. And this brings me to a point in
the faucet where
Kirk had some shots at me saying focus on the show, don't focus on the chat. But I actually had a chat with another immediate Titan bio dude, and he said BA Kirk was wrong. Focus on the chat. Don't change who you are. So don't I will
respect the chat.
I do respect the chat. So I have to say I'm going with bio dude. Kev Bart said BA is the best, and let's go. So we're We're gonna respect
Patrick Ford after last minute canceling. Said John, Joe, and I were on a tilt. Which
did he actually cancel last minute?
I was expecting to be on here with Steve Snell and the Drip Lord. So that's Texas Switch. So as far as the
Freddie Lynn said, "BA is good." John and Warren,
as far as his fucking his comments from the sidelines. Sorry, you had to step out.
Can we all at least take solace and at least Trent South is not here?
Yeah,
could be worse.
Can we have him host? Can you just get out of here, BA, and let him?
I got a question. Will Mutt get a full-time job by the end of 2024? I mean, we're only 2 months in. We're a month and a half in.
He has to. Yes, 1,000%. He has to.
Will it be in media content?
No.
He's probably going to deliver alcohol for his brother or something.
There's nothing wrong with that. Nice full-time job. You get the 401k, get the steady paycheck.
If you're him, do 30 to 40 hours at a normal, full-time job, and then do a podcast beyond a Patreon on the side. There's nothing wrong with
that. How many hours does it take to write a fucking Mutt stack? It takes
two?
I can bang that out. I could bang that out in 30 minutes.
The news could happen on Monday, and he doesn't even send it out
early. All joking aside, who gives a fuck? Nobody.
Steve from Gloucester is more successful as a entrepreneur than Mutt.
I won't dispute it. How could I? How could you? How could I?
We brought up Steve from Gloucester a second. Steve from Gloucester, I call the Steve stack, where he DMs everyone the same message over and over. Montante is part of the Steve stack, where you don't sign up for it. He signs you up for it. His Steve stack this week was the good guys. The good guys got this week. Did you get this one?
Yeah, Patrick Ford. I'm locked for next week. Lock for next week. Big get for the network. Thanks,
Steve from Gloucester. He messaged me. He said, "Not a week to be a KMS nice guy. Dave or Danny, Gig, Coleman, myself, and even you."
What's with the fucking gig hate? Way. What's with the gig hate? Joe, you hate Gig?
No, I thought he was great in the show. I thought he was fine.
Montante, did you hate fucking Gig on the show?
Sorry, go ahead, Montante.
Sorry, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
Oh, terrible. Oh, horrific.
I don't think he was.
Expand.
I'm not a big guy. He's one of the nicest Minifans of all time. I view my Mount Rushmore nice guys. He wasn't like being a tryhard. He was doing bits and voices and stuff, and it just made me uncomfortable.
I don't like the bit voices. I think I didn't think he was terrible, but I don't think he was in the upper echelon of he was no Steve from Gloucester or Montante on the show.
So as a person that's been in there several times, a couple times,
he was probably a peg below you, Tim.
I was going to say compared to a fucking standard Tim Ridgels fucking, like I said, fourth out of the bullpen, I'm going to give you an inning or two. Like I'm just dog shit. But I don't understand the gig.
It was nowhere near a bad third seat. It was fine. I thought he was great.
Thank you, LR Toker.
LR Toker said Gig had a terrific show. But Gig's episode was polarizing. Some people loved it. Some people hated it. So.
Julie dragged him down.
You could have had, who's the guy from Hamilton with the funny name?
Otsella right there.
Otsella said, "I like Gig." Julie ruined his chances. Deep throwing that mic to laugh for 2 seconds. Otsella.
I like Julie. Can we all agree that I'm under the belief that she felt like she was floundering and having a down show? So I think she made up the sleeping with Kirk dream.
Ever since she started working for the show and Kirk was kind of talking more shit about her, because before she took that dot in the I's, cross in the T, Kirk was like, "Oh no, she's great. Love Julie on the show." And then when she got a little bit of criticism from Kirk on the show, she was like, "Oh no, no, oh," you know what I mean?
More importantly,
I'm down on Julie right now. Pizza Joe, down on Julie.
Did she cry? Dan Berner said the Julie era needs to end.
Did she cry?
No, but she got as close to the crying.
Menner said, Menner said in the chat, 100% Julie finger blasts about Kirk.
I think that's true. I actually think
that's different than having a wet dream about him.
Yeah, she's beating that. She's rubbing that.
I agree with you, Montante, that that was a lie. I don't think that was true.
I think she found herself all right, 2 hours in here, I haven't really had a moment. This is, I'll exaggerate the truth here.
Do you think Menner's pleasures himself to the thought of her slapping the bean to Kirk? like
manners is a horny
like,
fuck.
Like Inception masturbation, where it's like I'm in like a masturbation within a masturbation.
I won't put anything past manners.
Fantastic.
Manners is a horny fuck. My last thing about like the kind of the Minifans Mayo on the show. Mayo on the show says that him being selfish is a bit. Like, Mayo is delusional. I have to say, he's a delusional guy. But he's like, oh yeah, it's just a bit. I act more selfish than I am, or you know what I mean? Like, Mayo's nuts.
Mayo, this was the first time I ever heard Mayo. I remember being like, I can't do it. This guy's the worst to ever do it. Then his second to fifth time, I actually like found myself like maybe I was wrong. This was a blast from the past. This was similar to his first appearance. His last appearance was horrific. I wanted to harm myself. If that's what he's going to do every time, never again. Don't do it. Horrific. Can't do it.
Mayo's super. So, like, class was about to end.
He was too annoying. He was too annoying last time.
Mayo's that kid I think about, like, in high school when the teacher's about to end class and hasn't said anything about homework. And then Mayo's like, oh, wait, do we have homework tonight? And the teacher's like, oh, yeah,
no,
we actually.
Mayo's the guy.
You had a guy in there exposing, exposing to all of like, Joe, the general public a fucking pyramid scheme. Like, he's literally, like, telling you, like, I have this, like, shell company where obviously he's, like, importing fentanyl or doing something nefarious where it's like, yeah, I have this company, and then everyone that does everything for my company is all within this company. Those people, they're not there under their own will. And Mayo might actually be like an international, like, fucking.
It would be gangster. Funny if Mayo,
dude, those warts and shit, those warts, like the bad guys in those movies, like they always have them.
It would be funny if Mayo. It would be funny if Mayo's hiring like illegal immigrants to like run his seminars for pennies on the dollar.
You don't want Mayo in there. And then it's like, Mayo being in there.
You look at Mayo's team. It's like Consuela, Juan, Jose.
Good for him for actually opening up about that.
I'm going to start hiring his company and sending it to just random people that I know is like businesses.
I don't like Mayo. I mean, I like Mayo, so I hope his like business does well. But his business is like the part of work that most people hate, like going to these bullshit like meetings.
Yeah, no, you quit a job over that.
Imagine how much you'd have to pay for that much exposure for your fucking shitty shell company. Like, dude, you just got like 40 minutes on a podcast.
But people will do, like, companies will do this because they have to do this kind of stuff. So I hope he is successful. But Mayo being like, okay, guys, it's not going to be me talking. It's going to be you talking. This seminar is interactive. Yeah. It's like, I'll be there like, fuck, why did I have to go to this?
It's my favorite moment of the week. I'm sorry. It's my favorite moment of the week.
It should be.
I'm trying to sneak in my Mayo homework thing so bad. We're going on minute four. Mayo is the kind of guy that there's 3 minutes left in class and he goes to the teacher, hey, are you going to like collect the homework from last night? That's Mayo. Mayo's the only guy in the class who did the homework and is like, hey, are you going to like take that or not? And everyone's like, this guy fucking sucks.
That's Mayo's business model should be, hey, if you want to get if you want to squeeze an employee out, have them sit through like 12 hours of the Mayo seminar and they'll quit. You don't have to fire him. They'll quit, you know, just make them keep going to Mayo.
He might be a genius. Like, by exposing this right before he went on, he might be. He got like a 30-minute infomercial for his infomercial. It's insane. He's a genius.
When Mayo blamed the Minifans for him quitting his old job and starting this, that was fucking bullshit.
That was good. I was going to reach out to Mayo. Wait.
Hey, this might be another. Hang on. So, John Featherston didn't like really, really, really straight up dox fucking Andy Mayo.
Yeah, but like, do you think the do you think a community college is gonna fire a guy because he's tweeting stuff about a podcast?
Yes,
on
yes, they will.
First of all, it's not about,
he fully doxed him.
It's not about
Pizza Joe, like, he fully doxed him, and a college will fire you for that. All time low from Featherston. So a college will fire you for this type of shit. Hang on a second, Joe.
Did also Mayo do something to piss off Featherston and all the other Minifans?
Piss off? Tim, go ahead, make him angry online so you fucking ruin his life in real life? That's fucking psychotic.
I'm not like being an asshole on that, but my point is, like, you don't. Oh, that is. But ACL. My thing is, I don't think the community college is going to fire someone because they're
At the very least, he has to have uncomfortable like meetings with these with HR or something like that. Like, so it is. It's like maybe he's not going to get fired, but he has to. Like, it is a shitty thing to do. It's definitely.
Now I'm simping for Mayo. So Coleman simping for all those losers. Like, I'm simping for Mayo right now. This is disgusting. I want to kill myself. Like, but dude, he got fucking fully doxxed by this asshole. So
yeah, John Featherston went too far.
There's never it hit a car for doxing people unless you sexually assault someone or something. There's never an excuse to fucking go after people's job. Mayo is like, he's so able to trigger people. Like, he's partly to blame. Like, let's be honest. But yeah, come on, Joe. Come on, Joe. Pull your head in.
Sorry.
Do you want the Minifans going after your pizza restaurant or something because of how shit you were on the show that time? Like, some stuff's got to be offline.
But Mayo did the same shit, so he can't fucking complain about it.
But Mayo never
Mayo doesn't dox people.
Yeah, he didn't try to, like, go. He went after the show.
Two wrongs don't make a right, but he did something very similar. So I think Featherston's a fucking scumball for doing that, but Mayo is not completely innocent. They're both wrong.
He wasn't completely
innocent. He even admitted on the show because Kirk even said it. And Mayo was like, well, yeah. So
there should be no. Like, don't do that shit in the first place. Ooh.
I think work is off limit. Work, family, should be.
I agree. Work and family is off
limit. I think work, family, and TGI Friday addiction should be off
limit. Yeah. I couldn't disagree. I could not agree with you more.
Dude, half price buzz. Who's gonna decline half price buzz? KaleJack.com, by the way.
Fridays has the best mozzarella sticks in the game.
If you if you want to support a local charity, Cash App, Daver R19 on Cash App, half price mozzarella sticks today only at TGI Fridays. Daver R, send it to them and show proof of your receipt. So
use hashtag.
Show proof. Screenshot it.
It's too funny. What can we go? One thing, it was kind of funny to see, to see Kirk talk about, like, his kids kind of wanted to start a Disciples podcast.
I thought he said they started a podcast.
Right? I think he joked around saying him and his on the untitled, unnamed show. He said, his son, a bunch of 11-year-olds could figure it out, but we can't. But I thought it was funny, like, if the Disciples podcast, when it started, it went over like bad podcasts, and it just played KMS, and they were like ripping KMS, be like, look at this old guy talking about, hey, my good man, or just ripping KMS. So I thought that was funny, but it was kind of nice to see the kids be talked about in that manner, but. I thought that was funny. Like, if you like War of the Roses comes on, like, look at this old fucking asshole talking about the War of the Roses. Like, who would listen to this? Like, they do what Kirk did at the start. So,
but ice fishing. What the fuck is ice fishing?
Ice fishing. Madawaska or whatever. So, what else? So, what you guys got? Anything? I have a few other things.
I had a quick. Justin Trudeau. So Justin's taking a lot of hate right now about potentially being a snake, all that. Don't care about that. Means nothing to me. Justin's not a snake. He's the man. Great guy. His lack of knowledge about the Star Wars original trilogy. And granted, like, I understand you grew up as a kid watching Star Wars. Like that, so if you grew up watching the prequels as your like childhood ones, you feel the same
Len
way.
Len Callahan,
like
you're talking about Len Callahan.
Not knowing that, like, fucking George Lucas only directed one of them, or like Kasdan, like there's certain things, like, and I would never not believe him, not trust him, and I believe he loves the movies, but I think they're in like a trivia debate, like Jeff D. Lowe. As of that moment, minus 6, 7, 50, and you gotta like, it might even go up. Like the smart money is gonna be pouring in. Like the sharps are gonna be banging that line until it probably gets to like 8, 9, 50. Like he is bad.
I consider myself like out of like the only like hat like nerdy thing that I is Star Wars. I thought George Lucas directed them all, but I'm not like Justin where I'm willing to challenge Jeff D. Lowe at a trivia contest on it. If you ask Justin just off the movie, not writers, directors, or anything like that, just off the movies, I think Justin could win. But if you add all the other stuff in on the outside, I think he would lose. We proved
it on the show. I think it's moved into like whale territory where
Jeff DeLoe? Yeah. About Jeff DeLoe?
Jeff DeLoe. He's like some Irish.
He's like some Scottish.
That was problematic. That was problematic. That was troubling for Justin as far as that
what
goes.
What about Cole? This kind of got overlooked a bit, but Coleman telling Kirk to move on when they're talking about gambling. Or
I think Mick tried to defend. I was there that day too. I would have done the exact same thing that Coleman did. But the only difference would have been when I got fucking my dick slapped in for doing it. I would have been like, all right, well, the reason I did it is X, Y, and Z. Kill me if you want. Coleman did the right thing there. Did the right thing there. It's easy to say after retrospect, like, oh, I shouldn't have said anything. Kirk, I guess, obviously knew what he was doing. So he was not going to cross the line or say too much. But I 1,000,000,000% understand what Coleman did. And if he did not do what he did, I would have been surprised. Justice for Coleman.
Well, I don't think you should tell Kirk to move on, I guess, like, because you know Kirk's not gonna go to, like, it's almost like you're scared.
Yeah, but that's an easy thing to have an oversight on.
I also like, think
I can't like, believe you just crucified him over the Keegs and Carlin tweets and then the Kirk move on thing.
I call it like I see it.
Now, do you think that Coleman would do that again, though? Knowing the reaction he got from Kirk.
He'll never do it again. He'll never do that again, but I think his original instinct was the right one.
I think also his vernacular or whatever is a little bit like he's not – the way he says stuff sometimes maybe isn't how he means it, you know?
He's going to be a nice late-in-life conservative. Like, once young Jack, he tastes that fucking income tax, and he starts looking at things like fucking, like, bequeathment taxes and, like, inherent. Like, he's gonna be one of those late-in-life fucking
1,000% agree. Do you?
100%.
Kev Hart said it. Dad is there's no
yeah shot. Pussy doesn't matter. My retirement account matters. Like I don't no care shot. About Coleman's pussy anymore.
Dad is a liberal. Like there's no way. No. I know too many Jersey kids in college. There's no way these guys all have money.
No way.
More Republicans. Yeah, dude. MAGA. Dude.
It was like it's like
but Kurt Coleman's like a mama's boy. I bet you
he's a mama's boy. I wouldn't be surprised if he got breastfed till he was like 5 or something crazy.
Oh, you think?
Oh, it's just
Coleman got breastfed till he's 5, eh? Wow.
Yeah, tweet it out. Facts.
Breaking news, Pizza Joe. Also, I thought a dead guy or almost dead guy leaving his wife in the car for 2 hours was awesome. Like
bring her in. Come on, man. Have her clean the bathroom at least. Like have her take a lap around the bathroom. Like, I mean, shit. Like, do something.
What an alpha, eh? Like the biggest, like, hey, babe, drive me here, and you're gonna be in the car.
Think of all the stuff that she's done selflessly for him. That's probably commonplace. She's a saint.
He looked like the jacked, you know, the guy in Avatar that's like the bad guy that like becomes the main bad guy. And he's like got the white hair, but he's like jacked, and he's in like that machine that walks around. Like he looked like that dude. So I. When he was sitting down at the very beginning, I couldn't get a read. And then when he said his age and Kirk was like, shut the fuck up. Like, no.
The music is about to come in. So let me get this in there. They were dead wrong on this. He should be dying his hair. He should be dying his beard. If he dyes his beard, which he should, because he's fucking dying, he would look 1,000 times better and no one would fault him for it. They were wrong with that. I disagree.
Yeah. He's probably got way too much going on to worry about dyeing his hair. That's my take on it.
Maybe you get him to dye his hair and try to sell a Just for Men sponsorship. Like, look, we turned this guy from the oldest looking 38-year-old back to a stud.
I feel like if you can't move after chemo for like 3 days and it's like, I could use some just for men, or I could lay here in like the worst agonizing pain of all time, thinking about my inevitable mortality. Like, or I could get a little comb into the beard of just for men. Like, dude, like, I don't know. Fucking, I don't know. Yeah, he looks incredible for his age, but when they said his age, it was shocking.
Play us out, Meadows.
Such a great promo, Kirk. All right, guys. I think that's it. Any final thoughts from you guys? Because we are gonna start if John's here. I don't know. Menner's Live, hosted by BA soon, where we can take calls. Any final thoughts, Tim or Joe?
I think that we're gonna start seeing Coleman getting shit on a lot more by Kirk. I think that's just gonna be a more common theme throughout the show, and I'm excited to see how Coleman handles it.
I think if Dave saw that tweet, and that's actually a real thing, and Dave Portnoy saw the tweet and was actually like annoyed with it, it could be funny.
I think it'll be exciting. The unnamed show will be funny to bring up Coleman, how he's a Carlin guy. So I think we have a lot to look forward to next week. So
suck a dick, Manners.
Manners, are you it? Are you here?
I'm here. I'm here, BA.
It's Late Night with Mad Menners. I'm your host. Hello, everybody.
Hello, everyone.
Hello, everyone. Menners till midnight. I will be taking your calls. I am also still alive. I haven't been fucked to death by Kowali. So stick it up your ass, Steve. It's really good to see someone while we're all on lockdown. That's it. It's always sort of been there, the women's game, but it's been ignored, so. They're fucking scared. I mean, look at Steve Robinson. Since he talked about his parents in the first episode, he basically lied since then because he's too afraid. He doesn't have the guts that Kirk has.
Hey, how are you? Welcome to Menners Live, hosted by BA. John, you have to update that intro to at the end. You have to put in, he hit a car. You have to put in that. You have to update
that. Hit a car. Was it
in
or
he hit a car?
The best drop.
Are the phone lines open, John?
Yes, sir.
Phone lines are open. Call in 844-906-3800. That's 844-906-3800.
Great mic in the fans. Great job, guys. Very
thank
good
you. I thought it was good. I try to go stick to my format, you know, this week. So
I tried everything that Montante and the other guy said. I would try to figure out a way in my mind in like 3 seconds to go against all of it. So
the first thing you brought up was a stupid golf tournament that about 8 people care about.
Dude, go McFuss Daddy. I've got money on McFuss Daddy. Dirty money, like it's dirty money.
The golf tournament will be on the networks on Monday.
Menners, really? break the stalemate here. We all agree unanimously that Gig is a good guy. What do you think of his appearance? Good or bad? You can't be in between.
Good. I didn't think anything of it. I'm biased because I love Gig.
I like Gig too, but you can be whatever.
And I just enjoyed it. I mean, he was in with Julie, wasn't he?
If he wasn't there, that episode could have been like potentially not great. Like I like Julie and shit, and like seeing her shows and stuff, like they're nice people, but like it, and like I don't bring shit when I'm on that show, like, but she really doesn't bring anything. And so like Gig at least was fucking funny. Like Gig's the man. Like I didn't get the bit
that he was on. Like I didn't get that vibe from him that it was too much. Maybe
I think it's people that have never met him in real life.
Like, I've met him multiple times. He's in my top four nicest Mena fans.
Like I said, I think he was in the middle for me. But that's who I am. John, no calls. What are you? John, fresh off his promotion to the executive team of the network. Congratulations, John. Much deserved.
Thanks, buddy.
Big spot.
Thanks, Mike.
And Menners, you said someone is taking over John's kind of intern role.
I offered.
Montante? It's been reorganized. I have a co-executive producer. You do have a call, though. Enough about me. 617.
It's gonna be
Trev. Welcome to Menner's Live, hosted by BA.
Hey, BA, Super Steve. Hey, thanks, Virgils, for telling the truth. Menner's, you really lost your fastball. See you later.
I knew that
was that Scuba Steve?
Super Steve.
Thank you, Super Steve. Yeah, that was a real
thing. Can we get the middle finger picture? Does anyone, is there a way to pull that up, please?
Fuck you, Mom.
John, you gotta get quicker to the drop the button.
Oh, fuck you.
But you knew that was coming. I knew that was coming.
Not on John. How the fuck with John?
Oh, I knew that was coming.
Can we settle this for a second? Like, because I've heard two different things. Okay, so was the Subaru Steve thing his mom like bitch slapping him in their basement because he made a mess of their bathroom or because he got caught jerking off at work?
I think he was too drunk.
Obviously, the Kirk Minahan network disavows that language.
How would John have known that's coming? That's insane.
It's okay. You're right.
You
have a caller. You have a caller.
Welcome, caller.
Is it Subaru Steve?
Welcome, caller.
Guys, 617, you're up.
Wow, welcome, caller. Welcome to Menner's Life.
I'm ruined.
What's up, Divya Martians?
Hey, bub.
What's going on? I'm having fucking withdrawals without any phone calls.
Call John the F word, please.
Do not.
Oh, I'm sorry. I can't stop thinking about what a little slut Coleman's grandmother is. I can't believe the story. I think she's out there trying to seduce these priests.
Yeah, she's they would call her a witch back in the day. She's that's like hot. Doing voodoo and shit.
She's got hash marks on her arm.
I'm getting Blanche from Golden Girls vibes of her getting all dolled up, taking these priests out to lunch, the dinner.
A nice 4:30 dinner. Mm.
I mean, she got paid to leave the country. Because she got knocked up, you know that was some married guy.
But do you think
we gotta get to the bottom.
Dan, do you think her offspring is one of a priest, a holy man? She's Coleman's actually in the lineage of a holy man.
A man of the
cross. She gets off like ruining a guy's entire life, like of work. Like this dude's like kept it celibate for like 70 years of his life. I'm gonna fuck it right at the end, so he goes to hell. Like she gets off on that. Like dang, she's really fucked up. Like really fucked up.
I'm sure Coleman spent some time with Father Flanagan in the rectory at BC. If you know what I mean.
That's where it all
we
started.
We are all going to lose our
that's
jobs.
That's where all the repression started. Hey, Dan, what are you doing all day while there's no calls? Like, do you just walk around doing bad bits to people on the street? What are you doing?
I'm just waiting for Kirk to say, let's take some phone calls. It hasn't happened. I'm fucking jonesing.
He's at Denny's. What's up, dip you mushes? Let me get a grand slam.
Well, at least you have
Menner's Life. Yeah, I know. Hey, it's good to hear you guys. But keep up the good work, boys. Hey, what do you like in the bowl, Montante? What do you like in the bowl?
Niners, big time.
What's your big time? Yeah, big time. I know. That's not good. That's not good. Two mushes liking the Niners. All right. Good luck.
Thank you. Bye, Mush.
520. Welcome to 520. Welcome to Menner's Live, hosted by BA.
I said in the chat to block Subaru Steve. I told you guys that was going to happen.
Who is that?
20 minutes ago.
Welcome, Bio Dude. Thank you for. Bio dude, I appreciate you.
No good. What's up?
Should have had an automatic buy to the finals in that fake fucking golf.
I know they did
automatic buy.
He said Chiefs by a billion now. Chiefs by a billion.
I'm just so happy that it turned out really good and it was.
Your connection sucks,
Bio dude. Your audio sucks. Go to a different spot. Call back.
John McAfee's yacht.
This guy fucking can't figure out audio. He has audio problems in the Fonz golf tournament. He can't figure it out.
I was telling BA earlier when I was at Mima's, I was watching a basketball game on TV, but I was streaming on Twitch. Bio dude playing with the Fonz boys, the tournament that got Menner's upset. I checked in randomly, periodically three times over the course of 90 minutes. Every time I went into Bio dude's stream, he was playing the same song from Weezer. I think it was I don't think it was Stacy's mom. What was the other song that Weezer had?
Island in the Sun.
No, it was in Africa. They botched that song.
Actually, Weezer's Island in the Sun. Buddy Island Holly. In the Sun.
No. I know that song.
Okay,
that song. Actually, it might have been Stacy's.
Say it
song.
Ain't so.
Stacy's mom. Every time I tuned in, he was spinning the little ball.
Beverly Hills.
None of the songs.
Beverly Hills.
Beverly Hills.
Every time I checked in three times over an hour and a half. Every time he was blasting it. I was like, what is this guy doing?
Subaru Steve is calling again.
Oh,
like let him in.
Keep your finger off the drop button. No. Hey, no. This is America. Free speech. You fucking little communist. Let him speak.
Hmm.
This is
John.
Leonard's
call.
He's a CEO.
Wow.
Easy.
Wow. That's unbelievable.
It's not unbelievable. He had a chance. He fucked it up.
So maybe he'll come back and apologize.
Some like Tonto's world where we drop the N bomb.
This is freedom of speech. Okay, yeah. You little fucking midget. You should have died from COVID. If God was real, you'd be dead right now.
Six five one.
Welcome to Menner's Live, hosted by BA.
Wow. Watch what you say, because it's not
Manners.
Hello.
The network has not been stronger, buddy. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling good, thanks. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling good. I was just catching up on you. I know you had the COVID. Feeling better?
Oh yeah, I was rough there for a few days. I didn't have enough vaccines. I only had two shots. I should have had five. Like
so most you're people. Updated. You're updated 8.
Yeah.
I got a Mary Fuck Kill for you.
Okay. I love this.
All right. We've got Big Titty Dooley, Power Bottom Mama K.
Oh, yeah, yep.
And Dooley the Act.
You can't go wrong with those three. Give me all three.
Yeah.
I'll kill myself after I fuck all three of them. That's the only way
to do it. Gotta marry the axe, I think. The axe you gotta marry.
Yeah, marry the axe. I don't know.
Dooley lost weight when she was in there.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I bang all of them, so it's really, I don't know, how do you, just, you know, take your pick?
I think you, that's tough. Who do you?
I'll kill them. Who would I kill?
Would you kill Mama K or Julie?
Mama K's got less to go, but.
Mama K is not just kinky.
Remember, she's
Mama K will live to 104.
And she's rocking you from the top, too.
Or anything, so it's kind of no great loss. Hmm. Anyway.
You don't have a car right now, but you did have a voice.
Hey, Manners. I found a cardboard box for you and I to sit on to sea level. Next time, deal evil cards.
That was it.
Sound like old Greg.
Old Greg. you do have a call now.
All right.
903.
Welcome to Menner's Live, hosted by BA.
That's
right. Menner's.
I know it's not.
Hello.
Menner's.
Hello.
Are we going to see you in the studio this year?
I hope so. Maybe the second half of the year.
When are we thinking?
I don't know. I haven't got an exact time yet.
If Menners is in studio, they should bring in a high chair for him so his feet can't touch the ground. Maybe that would be very good.
To throw a GoFundMe or something to get Menners to America. Menners
he has
America.
Money.
Menners, we need you in studio.
Trent, where were you tonight, buddy? You were supposed to be a co-host on Mike and Minifans.
This isn't Trent.
Montante is like, doing the mayo thing. We're trying to get
I mean, I'm
all right, Minifans. We need you in. We need you in, Minifans.
Thank you. But I'm really focused on the network. That's where all my energy and attention is. That's the main thing.
What's your take now? 4 or 5 days removed from Davergate.
Oh, I don't know.
No, you do know. Just fucking say it.
I think everyone agrees.
How are you the same guy who said it hit a car? What
he's
happened
soft
to you?
As baby shit. Like I've said it for you know, that's he just can't take it. As soon as we made jokes about him being a diva, he took it all personal.
Dude, this is an
epic. Ran away like a little bitch. Like he's I really like Dave. He's a super nice guy. I had a great time with him, but he's. You know, as you said it before, when things are going well, he'll jump in there, he'll pile on, he'll shit on people. But when the worm turns a little bit, he just cannot hack it. And, and that's probably why he sort of leads a relatively solo existence. Because
be a man.
what's happening when you alienate people like that. So
Be a Man Guy did say that Mama Kay is the queen of the Minifans. Do you think she's overtaken Lauren Lynn as that queen?
Have I missed anything? Is Lauren Lynn gone? I've seen her anywhere in like months.
If Be a Man said it, it's true. Period.
Be a Man saying it. He's the latest man.
That's the answer.
Have a caller? Wait, we have a caller.
3, 2, 1.
3, 2, 1. Welcome to Matters Live, hosted by
Joe's my queen.
Yes.
Go ahead, caller.
You're on, caller. Is this a bit? I think that was a bit.
That's the worst bit ever done on here. Can we please hang up? John, be a producer.
For some reason, executive producer hanging up on people. Anyway, the exciting news is Gig has been hired as the associate producer.
Wow.
So Gig's come onto the production.
Even after that performance the other week? Oh my God.
Gig is better in a marketing.
It also keeps him behind the camera. So I guess it's more an off-air role, Tim, which is important.
That's a good fit.
So now what I'm seriously saying now is, if you're a Minifan that's had an idea for a show or wants to get a different type of show on the network, maybe you've thought about it in the past, maybe you've even reached out. You know, now we've got John and Gig who are willing to produce shows. So reach out. There's a production team waiting. We've also got a couple of other people who can help if needed. So there's never been a better time than right now to join KMN.
Also, Manners, do you think that Steve from Gloucester, Kirk was right, that he should just stick to the 10, 12-minute shows, no more John producing, no more anything, just stick to what he knows, do what he's been doing. It was successful. Why change something that's working? He was played on the show every time.
Do we want to try to bait him right now and call him live and try to get him to say something out of school?
Yes, please.
Oh, you want to live it live? Oh, we have a caller?
520. Okay.
520, welcome to Matters Live, hosted by BA.
Let me know what it would say to bait him. Because we can't do it.
After I say the last line, that means the caller goes. Yeah. Sorry.
Hey, does this sound any better?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who's this?
How's it sound?
Hey, thank you for the advice to stick to the comments, brother. I took your advice.
Did I say that? I don't even remember.
What do you got?
How's it sound? Seriously, can I talk to him? Can we go back and forth?
You sound great, man. What do you got?
This is Bio, dude.
Yeah, that's fine.
That's it. I was just coming back to check it because I'm so tired.
Thanks, buddy.
John,
get rid of him.
We're gonna call Steve from Gloucester.
BA, what do we say to bait him?
Ask him.
Wait, let Manners go.
Ask him anything about Mean Streets or anything early Scorsese. Anything Scorsese.
No, I want to get him to shit talk somebody on here right now.
Okay,
I'm just going to tell you, though, that he submitted an episode just like a couple of hours ago.
Good. It's perfect. I got everything I need. He'll answer, too, because he's not doing anything else.
Steve from Gloucester live to
recording on his phone with no guests.
He's probably watching this.
Honor.
You could just call him the F slur and hang up.
That'd be great. Imagine he called me the N word and just hung up. Wow.
Imagine he picks up the phone. Hey, you fucking motherfuckers.
Yeah, that'd be great. If he answers, I'm going to say, hey, man, why did Menners just reach out to me on WhatsApp and just trash your most recent episode? Call me back, Steve. Call me back, Steve. That'd be fun. That'd be a good time.
So, that's the other news. He submitted an episode. He's not going to have guests on.
How long was it?
Maybe 15 minutes.
Oh, wow. You know what's great about Steve is you can suggest one thing and he never fights back one iota. He just goes with it.
Yeah.
Dan Berner is saying, can I do a show just about the network? That would be funny if you did a wrap-up show about the network, because there's a lot of stuff to check out on the network. So
a wrap-up show about the wrap-up shows?
Menners, if you want to fucking do what's in the box, like I said, like with Gig in place or whatever.
Yeah, absolutely.
We need like a fucking, there has to be some sort of cash incentive for the people participating, because people aren't going to want to do the things that are included in
the
box.
We need a TGI Fridays, half price mozzarella.
So, like, as far as it goes, if you want something that's different, just like kind of like All in the Minute Family was, like, it was completely different than anything like people have really tried, you know, essentially tried to do. I think we could do that with What's in the Box. I need 16 people and
okay, well,
like a grand.
Okay, we need a Dave.
Reach out to John and Gig. And then,
well, like I said, if you are actually looking for something different that's not a fucking Zoom meeting and something that might be actually interesting and unique, okay. I think we could pull it off.
Tim's looking for investors. Tim's looking for investors.
Good night, Tim. Yeah. Thank you.
Tim's right. If he wants to love that, would you invest? I would invest if it's like $200. I'll give $200 to invest in What's in the Box. So Tim, I'll be an investor.
Should we bring him back in?
Tim's been good.
You're such a clit. What the fuck? Dude, we could do it.
Well, you're just being on the network here, shitting on all the shows. Like, you go,
I wasn't shitting on anything.
He's trying to do something different, Manners. He's trying to
I wasn't shitting on anything.
You don't have to shit on everybody.
What did
else
I specifically shit on?
You were saying, you go back and watch the tape. It's pretty clear.
No, he was saying that he wants to do something original, not a wrap-up show.
He doesn't need to shit on everybody.
He was saying
there's never been a competition show on this network. I'm willing to provide that.
Tim was saying
it'd be perfect for Gig and his bits.
Tim was saying if he wants to do a show on the network, we need to crowdsource $1,500 for prize money to do a show. I would invest.
No one's going to want to do the things that are involved, and they're not harmful to yourself physically, like as far as outside of like disgusting or potentially.
Can I give the best idea for a competition show on here? It's a simple one. It's Meadows coughs absolutely disgustingly. Next time, turn off your camera too when you do that. A little KMS version of the dozen, where there's three or four rounds, at least half.
Tim tried to do it.
No, it's but at impossible. Least but at least half of them are KMS. The other two are like sports or whatever. But actually have real money and have somebody that who's not Daver handle it. If you had one or two shows a week and it lasted 4 or 5 weeks until the finale, that would do numbers. Because if there's money involved, people actually can care about it and be competitive and cry, bitch, and moan. That would be good.
Different stuff like that and incentive based. You need to find the investors. What do you? No calls, John. Sorry.
No.
Okay.
John, how are you doing, buddy?
Great. Why? What's up?
Oh, no, you just been for once very quiet tonight. Thank God.
Trying to take people's advice.
Good.
So
good.
Someone did DM me saying Freddie Lynn is losing his fastball.
Wow.
Oh my God! I agree with Kirk. You suck.
You have an anonymous call.
Anonymous, welcome to Menner's Live, hosted by.
I wonder who this might be.
I hope it's Super Steve.
I hope so too. I hope it's Mom.
Hey,
Montante.
What's your lifetime gambling losses? And don't lie.
What's my what?
Lifetime gambling losses.
Well, the $20,000 with a guarantee.
How much you down?
Jess was $20,000 straight.
Yeah, was it 20?
I don't know what that was.
Anyway,
if I had to guess, probably
was it between
50 and 110?
Okay.
Yeah.
why don't
you quit?
Dude, this is a sport. This is an occupation solely based on statistics and numbers and math. And he goes, it's somewhere between 60 and 110.
No, the $20,000 was a big one. I would say between 35 and 70.
It's all about being like dead on so analytical, and he's just like, I don't know. There's like a $90,000 spread in there.
Well, that's over fucking 15 years. So,
yeah. Dude, that's how it goes.
Anything else, buddy?
Yeah. Why don't you just quit, Montante, instead of just losing?
I would rather kill myself than not have to game. Like,
you need a Dana White.
Gambling is a good time. I would rather live and lose than not lose and live.
Now we need one of those addiction things.
I can't believe you lost 30-40k with betting $10 parlays, man. That's crazy. That's a lot of bets.
You should have got in on the Dave or Ponzi.
I can't believe you made a $20,000 bet. Like, I've never made a $20,000 bet. That's a humongous.
No, it was a future. It lost.
I understand it's a future, but that's a humongous future.
How did you pay that off, Montante? Kirk said on the show it was $200 for 2 years every week. Is that true?
It wasn't 2 years because I explained last night with Big Tone. The Jets started off that year 5-2 or 5-3, but it was a future, so it didn't cash as soon as they won the fifth game. So I had time to put money aside. I think I had like between $3,000 to $4,000 or $5,000. I handed to my bookie, and he's like, "Well, where's the rest?" And I said, "Oh, I don't have it." He's like, "Well, what do you mean you don't have it?" And I was like, "Well," he's like, "Why'd you bet that much?" I was like, "Oh, I thought I was gonna win." But yeah, it was $200 probably a year and a half, and I paid it off. He knows where I live. It was good. It wasn't a big deal.
Meme said Montante has the craziest handwritten gambling log he's ever seen. How many books are there? How many books of a gambling log?
With your units,
it's probably like 15.
Each day gets its own page.
Did the bookie have to meet you for lunch at your work once a week? Like,
no. I had the common courtesy to either drive to him.
Okay. Can I ask just a couple questions as a person that's done like massive action like in my life? Like, how long had you been gambling in your life prior to you making this bet? Like, and primarily, let me finish. Were your bets like spread bets as far as like everything's zeroed out like by the statisticians, or were you doing like primarily parlays and stupid shit? Like what were you doing and like how many years were you doing it leading up to you betting $20,000 in the Jets season total wins?
I started gambling my sophomore year of college. I was 19, and I was a diehard Jet fan. Okay. I was 7 years ago, so I was 24, 25. I reached out and I had my credit limit raised from $3,000 to $4,000 to 20, and I put all $20,000 on Jets under.
Before that, were you mostly working with like action, like spread betting, like you would do in
normal stuff?
Was it the 20K bet? Was it the money line or was it a spread?
No, it was Jets over under 4.5. It was under 4.5 wins.
Under 4.5.
But prior to that, you weren't into exotic shit. You were into like actual gambling.
No, it was one of those moments where I just wanted to
see what his level of like gambling experience was before he was like, "Hey, give me a 20K marker. I'm gonna put it on the fucking
20 grand on the Jets over 3.5 wins."
I pinpointed an automatic win, and I pounced on it.
Yeah, you lost. Montante, probably has 100.
I never knew this about Montante. I love him more now. Like,
we have a caller. 978. Welcome to Menders Live, hosted by BA. Thanks for waiting.
If you see a Chinese bar today, wish you a happy new year. Be a man.
It is the Lunar New Year. Thank you, be a man. So be a man. Fuck Mary Kill.
He would take all three of them
into the night
shed. Into the shed, bud.
Holy shit, dude.
Yeah. You had another caller, but they hung up.
But they hung up because Tim wanted to know. Montante has like 100 pages of books of bets he's done because he's done big bets and now he does $5, $10 to win big.
$100 big, you scumball.
Yo, 20 grand is that's the biggest one I've done by a mile. That's a really big
bet. All right, we got a caller. What's the number?
By a mile.
617.
Welcome to Menders Live, hosted by BA.
All right, Super Steve again. I want to apologize for my language earlier. I'm very sorry about that.
No.
I would say, do you think it's worth? Because he might be slow playing.
Yeah, that was a slow play, I think.
That was a slow
play. It was. That's why you keep him on.
Yeah.
This is not the Montante's world.
The Menders is Menders, the CEO you're such a for a reason.
I want to.
This is a CEO move.
If one slips through, I can't really be blamed, but if I let the guy keep coming on, they can say you're an idiot. So
yeah, it's not. You got to think.
Is he gone, John?
Is he gone? John's talking to him.
John's so dumb.
He's the best producer in the world.
You muted me, you tiny little shit. Don't say I'm a fucking idiot. Fuck you. 860, you're up.
860, welcome to Menners Live, hosted by BA.
Connecticut.
Hey, guys.
860.
Hey.
Mayo.
By the way, I think the Chinese New Year is until tomorrow. Not to nitpick.
Hey, be a man. Don't look at calendars. Be a man.
If you're in China, it's technically tomorrow.
Yeah, in China, it's probably in China right now.
Be a man. So. It's as big in the Asian community, so he would know.
I was just going to say, doesn't that support what Montante said about Italian guys and Asian women?
Yeah. 100%.
Yeah, it does. And by the way, just calling to defend Montante because if he lost 40 grand, I think he said it right. He looks at it as entertainment and he likes to do it. So I don't see what the big deal is at all. People collect things and spend tons of money on it. And
you know what I mean?
Yeah. It's like a daily Disney Plus subscription. It's like a daily Disney.
It's like
a daily Disney Plus subscription with rebates, you know.
You got it.
It's like any other hobby. Hobbies cost you money. Golfing costs you way more than $40,000 over a day.
Exactly.
Like guaranteed. And like any other hobby costs you, like it can count. This is one of the only things as far as like ammunition
collecting. Incentive-based hobbies. 203.
That can actually return.
Hold on, Colin.
Oh, 203. Well, yep. 203, welcome to Menners Live, hosted by BA.
Hey, yeah, I was just calling Montante. I got a little advertising question for you about KMS. My company is looking to get involved.
You're hired. Go ahead. Good
start. Yeah, my name is Big Jim Romini, the asbestos mitigation king of New Jersey, you fucking loser.
We don't have any room for you, pal. Sorry. Call back funnier next time.
Who is this? What's the joke?
The Romini.
Call back.
Dude, you might have just started a war with the Romini.
Yeah, I don't know
you
what happened.
You might not want to fucking do it.
You owe that person money, Mike.
I don't owe anybody money.
Hey, Mike, it's Romini.
That's a Montante donor. I'm really deeply uncomfortable. He's donated before to the Montante fund.
No one say my name on this. Steve is calling again.
And by the way, only 3 Minifans have loaned me money, for the record.
I had a question. It's kind of weird, though. It's a kind of a Kemp question. What do you think Kirk is primarily looking at his phone when? Because he's always looking at his phone during episodes.
The live chat. And
is it also? Is it notes? Is it his notes? Is it Twitter? Is there a YouTube chat? Or is it his DMs? Does he have like a private chat?
All three.
But what do you think his first one he goes to? Like, does he have
Twitter.
His DMs?
Twitter for sure.
Twitter,
1,000%. Then he goes to the live chat. Then he goes to his DMs. 100%.
Oh, I think Twitter, then DMs because he's already in Twitter, then the live chat. I don't even know if he goes to the live chat. Why would he go to the live chat?
I think if he says he doesn't go to live chat, that's a lie because he looks at it from
when things are going wrong. He does just so he could shit on people and be like, "Oh, there's people saying."
But he has to always look to see what's going on.
Yeah, maybe.
I think he looks at his DMs. I think he has some people that send him. Like he has a private chat because he has a private chat sometimes. So
there's a comment that says Kirk's the man.
Kev Bart said Kirk's the man. Sorry, Kirk, for reading the comments.
Do you think there's anything more to the Kirk shitting on Coleman than just him trying to annoy him? Like, do you think Kirk's actually trying to like slowly push him out? Like he's playing the long game?
I think he does that with everybody. He's slowly pushing out everyone of his life.
I think he's breaking him in. Like he's just trying to like be like, you got to take some heat too. I gave you a pass, now it's on you. Like he's mentoring him in his own way. On air, he's like an on air mentor kind of, you know.
I have cancer.
Side question, like different.
Need to hit whatever, a car job.
But do you think when Dave said the thing about the only person that could do this job is that nutcase up in Boston? Do you think him and Kirk had spoke before that behind the scenes? No. Or do you think Dave is that big of just like, he's literally just like this way, this way, this way. And he has to sit and focus for a second. He just goes, you know who could do this? Kirk. And like, he just said that.
He knows damn well that Kirk is his biggest old school barstool guy that he has at the company right now. And then
like the closest to KFC radio, like with him and KFC, like where they're fighting and stuff.
But if Kirk's called upon, he'll answer the call. He knows that
it was shown on the show. Kirk reached out to Portnoy first.
Of course he did. Of course, to
start Barstool Radio. Kirk is trying. I think Kirk's come along to the Barstool Club because he grows his audience.
I don't know if he specifically said that. I think he was saying when
Portnoy said it on the show.
Dave said the thing as far as the only person that can do that. Like seconds later, Kirk DM'd him or contacted him or texted him or whatever.
But yeah, Kirk reached out first.
Do you think there was anything prior to that? Like as far as that, that's what I was asking.
I don't think there. I think it was like Kirk heard Dave say, oh, Kirk's the only one that can bring the show back, and Kirk pounced on the opportunity.
That's what it like definitely seems like. I just wondered if there was maybe anything like beforehand as far as, you know.
I guess beforehand, they always wanted Kirk to do radio. Remember they said two calls for Willie Colon?
Of course. Why wouldn't you want a racehorse to fucking race? You know what I'm saying? Like, Jesus Christ.
No,
100%. I've always said like Portnoy and Kirk when they're on mic together, it's fucking magic. So this is
and just then Whitney ideal. Too. Yeah.
I think there were too many voices in that show. But then once the Nate stuff started happening, I'm like, this show is actually perfect. There's nothing wrong with it at all. What was I thinking?
Kirk actually one of the greatest podcasts in America was
Kirk.
Like
Kirk had a meeting of the minds experience on Barstool Radio. You know what I mean? He really did.
We gonna kick Tim out of here. And then
shout out John from Warren for bringing up meeting.
What were you gonna say, Manners?
I was just gonna say Nate is really awful. Like I didn't know him before, but he just comes across as
he's the dog.
He just yells.
And he thinks awful. What do you mean?
Well, just all that stuff about him going to print that the Ohio State guy was a pedophile to try and get him fired from his job, and then saying it was the all a joke.
The best point someone made was
that's a big nuke. That's like a big nuke. No, but you know
the best point that someone made was you can go backstage and then take a screenshot, and then it gets around. So he can say he has final say on what gets released, but someone can go backstage. Take a picture of it, and it might as well have been released.
Well, even the fact that just it was brought up now, this kid's name and that are in articles or whatever together. Like he's still a teacher, you know. Even the fact that it was mentioned is bad.
It was like a nuke threat, and he's like, "I could do this nuke on you." You know, you know what I mean? It was fake news.
But the great part about Nate is Nate is similar to like Kirk and Rico and those people where he can be fucking just fucking he's being read a fucking email that he wrote.
Is terrible on air.
He's just like no. He's
terrible on air.
No.
Not as bad as KFC, but he's not good.
He's John from Scranton Lights John, you know what I mean? He's kind of like John from Scranton. Actually, John from Scranton has more on air talent than Nate. You know, and that's it. You know, that's
Menner's. At least I've consistently run a show.
Ironic when Kirk was in there because on that conversation because he makes about 10 pedophile jokes every game.
By the end of it, he was like, you know what? I'm on Nate's side.
I was calling it late at noon. Yeah. Or Nate at Loon for L. Do Bruce Steve in the chat said you're all terrible on air. I would think Menners isn't.
Yes.
Menners.
At least I don't have my mum beating me up on air. I mean, that's a good thing, isn't it? Do Bruce Steve. You know, at least, you know, BA's mum doesn't come in and slap him and call him a drunk right now. I mean, that's true. Think you're a bit that fucking of an idiot to say we're terrible on air.
I'm gonna take
that. Even Montante, I don't see Montante slapping him around.
We're all terrible on air. Except for
Just another weekend for you.
We're all terrible on air besides Menners. Menners has talent. Hit a car, that broadcast. Menners has on-air talent. Even Kirk would admit that. Like, I would think Kirk
He did admit that.
He has on-air talent. You're a better broadcaster than Mutt Manansky. If you were in Mutt's spot, you'd be broadcasting, you know?
And he has better work ethic than Mutt. All joking aside.
Killer said it's a 5 out of 10 night.
Killer Kowalski. Killer Kowalski is like pissed off. Got banned. I got him the most clout he's ever had in his life. He was on high now. Killer Kowalski, you know.
And so, okay, let's just wrap this up because it's getting late and we're coming to a grinding halt. But
yeah, no more calls.
The network news. I'll wrap it up, BA. Johnny Boy. So how are you feeling about the new executive producer role? Are you and Gig ready to smash out some new shows? Like, yes. How's KMS Rewind coming?
It's coming out great. Yeah, it's gonna. Our first guest. Sorry, I was hanging up. Our first guest is gonna be VD, and I'm trying to get Danny. So
I would think
fuck you to Tabor, I guess. But
it should be VD and Danny. Danny should do it with VD and keep it quantum.
Yeah, that's fine if they want to keep. But Danny's schedule is trash. So,
but yeah, I think bringing multiple people to do
it. Yeah, that was my goal. I'm going to produce it, and anyone who wants to do it can do it.
Two people can do it anywhere. It's what Menners and me have said from the start. If you look at it, me and Menners have said this from the start. It should be open to everyone, and we were right. That's why we're in leadership.
Slowly destroyed Dava psychologically, and then the final hammer, dropping the rundown with that stuff in it.
Meme said the cloud vacuum sucking up all the cloud. I think he's talking about me.
And so dropping on the network at tomorrow morning. You got another consistency podcast,
which I didn't produce, didn't even know about. So Steve, I guess did the right thing.
Yep. And then there should be a KMS rundown coming with Red, Sheldon, and Justin Trudeau. So no doubt that'll be a good show. It's a lot to keep you all busy. Anything else before we wrap this up?
I have an idea for a KMS. It's a wrap up show, but a show.
Yep.
Go on.
Can I pitch it?
Yeah.
Every week, whoever runs it has to produce it and keep it tight to the vest. But you have two or three co-hosts every week, but you don't tell the other co-hosts who the people are. So you can have clashing people on to go over KMS stuff and just throw topics in the middle of the snake pit.
I like
that's that. Actually not bad.
Just love the snake pit. What was the Thunderdome?
So people like fighting shit. Like you can sneakily have them on and talk KMS.
What was the Discord? What was the Discord channel we had for fights?
I like it. Not bad.
No, I don't mind it. Yep.
Run it. Someone has to do the legwork.
Run it through the executive producer team.
That sounds like a me job more than
it is.
I like Montante. You would have to book the guest. You would have to book the guest.
I'd be fantastic at that.
Yeah,
they'll listen to you. Like no one wants to let you down. Like you got that. Yeah. You got that.
Point. Because I think it's
I like the audacity of just I'm going to fucking have Kirk say I don't want another rundown show, and then
that's a different show. That's a
legitimate, show. Just straight up rundown show. That's fantastic. No, that's audacious. And if you're gonna do it, all right, you're gonna go hard.
We're just gonna kick people out one at a time. So, Tim, thank you very much. Later. Good evening.
You're such a clip.
You did a great job tonight. Bye bye. And there goes Montante as well. That makes it easy. That's a good idea because I think, for example, like. Me and Red should have it out on air. Like he clearly still hates me.
I think they should do we need to do the me and you versus the rundown guys live. I think that's the best for the first Twitter show because I think it would be good. I think it'd be good. Ziggy told me that he will not DM me anymore because I say all the DMs he sends me on three different shows. So I guess I'm doing it again. But I told him like I said Kirk shares your DM, so it's like I'm learning from Kirk.
Ziggy's a bits guy, so he likes to sort of do one thing on air and be totally different in DMs. Whereas I'm kind of the same.
I'm bidding him. I'm doing. I know he's a bit guy, and I'm doing a bid on him by reading his DMs on air. So I'm like doing bitception, you know, with Ziggy. So
great stuff. All right. Thank you. Be a great
part of the team.
Yeah. Congratulations, John. You and Ziggy are going to make some great shows. Some great art, really. I'm really looking forward to it. So reach out if you want to do a show on the network. And take care, everybody. Have a great weekend. Another tough day at work.